Hey everyone, this is Johnny Lee. A lot of people have been asking about my deck list from these past few YCS performances. Trudrago's Sky Striker. And I've also just been wanting to connect with the community in a while to discuss like theory. As many of you who know me know, it's one of my favorite things to talk about, both inside and outside of the game. So we're in Rowling Hall right now. It's where I go to school at UT to do my MBA program with the Macomb School of Business. So yeah, if you just come with me. So basically, for this video, I'll go ahead and do my deck profile from the past three events that I played. And those events were YCS, Niagara, then Guadalajara the following week, and then last weekend was Fort Worth. So it was really cool. I mean, this is the first time I played three premier events in consecutive weekends. And it was also the first time that I found myself in Canada, Mexico, and the US all in the same week. So, I mean, it was definitely a really interesting travel experience, and I did well at all three events. It was nearly a three-peat in TOPS. I ended up bubbling Niagara and learning from the knowledge gaps and filling those gaps and doing well at Guadalajara. I placed 28th at the Swiss at Guadalajara and lost in top 32. I placed 7th at the Swiss at Fort Worth and lost in top 8. So that's kind of the summary of my performance. And so, as far as what we'll do today, let's go ahead and go in this room. So I have all my cards set up in here, so. As far as what we'll do today is I'll do my deck profile. Yeah, let's have a seat. And I don't need some water. I'll do my deck profile, and I'll go into theory. I'll talk about just details about my deck that you never asked for but didn't know you wanted. And then I'll talk about general theory, which I know some of you really enjoyed last time, 3 years ago, when I did that long video. And so I was hoping to revisit some, you know, classic ideas. And because the turnover rate in Yu-Gi-Oh! Is really high, I figured, you know, it'd be a value add to the community to be able to kind of rehash some of the fundamentals of competitive play, as well as maybe introduce a few additional points or experiences, you know, apart from what I've discussed already. I just came from a really intense week of three consecutive finals. I'm very, very deep in sleep debt. So, I'm not going to be my usual fast talking self. I'm definitely thinking slower and speaking slower right now. So if you find the pace of this video is too slow, I mean, by all means, you know, put it on like 2x speed. You know, definitely pretty dead right now after pulling all these all-nighters. Essentially, while playing these three events, I wasn't technically an active Yu-Gi-Oh! Player. I played, you know, my rounds in the tournaments themselves, but I didn't like, you know, practice, you know, discuss, think about, or play Yu-Gi-Oh! Outside of that. As you can see, like, I still did decently well. And so one issue that I will touch on later is, you know, how I was able to leverage just a number of factors to be able to succeed. Despite not being an active player in the game. But I'll go ahead and go into the deck profile now. So, you know, did really well at these events, and you can all bear witness to what I accomplished with a playset of Ignis. Now, you've seen some of these cards before. Here's a new take, though. What if we took Sky Striker Ray and added it to a deck with Trudrago's? And I also have the three Nibiru and one Spellbook Magician of Prophecy. That rounds out the monsters, but there's still a lot to see. So going into the event, I decided to try a plan where I combined the best cards from the two engines, like Engage, and diagram. I've been playing this game since most of y'all weren't even born yet. There's terraforming, set rotation, shark cannon, and striker hornet. I've got a lot of versatility. I can play anything from pendulum to dragon ruler to goat control. But this time I went with this heritage and the multi-role. All right, so this next part of the engine is pretty neat, so peep this. Spellbook of Knowledge and a pair of Spellbook of Secrets. Now, I'm neither a villain, but I'm barely a hero. I'm just trying to use disciples to target my Area Zero. And 2 days ago, the ban list dropped, and you can picture my anger when I saw that they had to hit my boy, Sky Striker, Widow Anchor. And to round out the main deck that was responsible for my accomplishments, we have the traps, one True King's Return, and three True Draco Apocalypse. Now that's 39 cards. Do I need to recount it and start anew? Nah, I just saved the best for last, because the most important card is Parvenu. Okay, so that was the main deck. And then for the extra, there's two Hayate, one Kagari, one Kaina, three Shizuku, one Hita, one Nightmare Phoenix, one Ningirsu, one Boreal Sword, one Clara and Rushka, and Dragostapelia and Starmbring Venom for Super Polymerization, and then Dingirsu. I have this old ARG token. It's for my field center. I have this token depicting Ed and I having rehearsed many times how to do the Tauntaun sticker pose and mastering it. We took this at Guadalajara. Shoutouts to Ed, my rock. Okay, so a quick comment on my extra deck strategy. So this is like this low-key approach that y'all don't know about. But basically, whether I lost a game or won a game, I always tried to close it out without summoning the third Shizuku, because that way, I'll always summon these two ultimate copies first, and they will assume that I play a third ultimate copy. But it turns out the third copy is just a super. I know, super pitiful, right? But yeah, if the trick is if you only summon these two, then they'll think you own a third, when in fact you don't actually have it. But jokes aside, just a quick kind of reach out to the community for anyone out there who's watching. There's a few cards that I'm missing to finish my deck in maximum rarity French, so I'm gonna go ahead and identify those cards. If anybody has them, I would really appreciate if you reached out to me. So one is Ultimate Dingirsu in French. If you have this in Ultimate, please reach out. Invasion of Vengeance, First Edition, Starving Venom Dragon, French. A playset of Hayate Ultimate in French. A pair of Kaina Ultimate in French. Of course, the third Shizuku that I kept pretending that I had but don't actually have. Let me go ahead and show it my side deck before I get into more requests. So, three No Material, three Infinite Impermanence, three Different Dimension Ground, two Shared Raiden Ogre, and three Superb Polymerization. That rounds out my deck for YCS Fort Worth. For YCS Guadalajara, this was a shared ride. And then for the event that preceded that, YCS Niagara, this was shared ride. These three cards were three, there can be only one. This was Predaplant Dragostapelia and Sky Striker Eagle Booster and Afterburners. And so instead of this Dragostapelia, I had a Chimeratic Mega Fleet. And instead of Dingirsu, I had a second copy of Kaina. And I will certainly explain those changes as I go into the in-depth portion. But back to the aside that I was on. just as a request to the community, if you happen to have a playset of Secret LCGX polys in first edition French, if you have a third shared ride, first edition French, or if you have a playset of these in ultimate French, please reach out because I'm missing that as well. And then just really quickly, among the main deck cards, if you have a magician, or actually if you have a set of magician, any number of magician up to a set of first edition ultimate French, please reach out. What else? I know this comes in a higher rarity, so let me know if you have this in French, super. And besides that, I believe that's everything I was missing for a max rarity French deck. So please let me know if you have any of those cards that I just mentioned. And so I'm gonna talk about the main deck first. And as I kind of resort these, I'll explain what I'm doing. So in his best-selling book, Road of the King, Patrick introduced, or he first coined the idea of categorizing cards as, you know, starters and extenders and stuff instead of monster spells and traps. When I returned to the game earlier this year, I was very, you know, pleased to find that these terms have become commonplace, because it was when the book first came out, you know, the vast majority of players are not competitive, and even among the competitive crowd, most players, you know, have not really heard of or read Road of the King. These terms were very obscure. But for those who remember the hour, you know, long deck profile video that I did 3 years ago, I took advantage of that opportunity to kind of introduce the idea of Patrick's terms of, you know, card roles, and kind of, you know, took his relatively obscure, you know, vocabulary set and kind of tried to bring it to the masses. And then if you've seen other videos, deck profile videos that David Flores and I, my test partner David Flores and I have done, you know, we've always tried to push for the idea of card roles. And so you can imagine that I was, you know, very satisfied when I returned to Yu-Gi-Oh! Earlier this year to find that players have now adopted that terminology. Because as you'll see in a second, it's so important to think about cards in terms of roles, not in terms of spell trap monster, because roles determine your deck building and deck choice. And by looking at it from that more dynamic perspective, you can be able to dismiss bad cards more easily and go for good cards and choose good decks. So I'll go ahead and illustrate what I mean by that. So let's take a look at the main deck first. So there's 13 starters. Okay. Right, 5, 8, 11, again, there's 13 starters. So I'll talk a little bit about the quantity and the quality of these starter cards. So, you know, past recommendation is that you play 11 to 14 starter cards, right? Because of the rule change where first player doesn't draw a card, the brick rate is high if you don't play like a higher number of starters. So any deck that can support a higher number of starters, like closer to 14 than 11, without having to play bad starters is definitely a good candidate for a deck in my eyes. So that was like one thing I noticed when I was considering what deck to play. So just quantity is important. So 13 is closer to 14 than it is to 11. So right off the bat, that's really good. That's really, really good. The second thing, though, is the quality of the starters. Now, that's where this deck just absolutely shines, and like it kind of just blew my mind away, is that if you look at this bottom row here that I've assembled, so 5, 9 out of the 14 cards. So what's 9 divided by 14? So, you know, 10 over 15 is like 66%. So it's like, you know, it hovers around 66%. It's like 2/3 of your starters all generate positive advantage. So like these net zero, right? Terraforming gets one card. This gets one card. I mean, it's kind of a negative one. But these starters all plus. If you open a bad hand but have engaged by itself, this ends in a plus one, more even. Same with these cards, same with this card, which is basically just engage. So this whole row of starters all plus. That's pretty incredible. Very few starters in the game truly plus so naturally like that. So these are really good starter cards. And on top of that, set rotation plus is like a million. So people online have been debating whether to call this deck True Draco Striker or Striker True Draco. The circle that invented it, we call it Set Rotation FTK because this card is crazy. So you play this and you get diagram, and then you set area zero to your opponent's side of the field, right? And so diagram, of course, is going to get you a card like Disciples, which, or if you already have Disciples, then just use that, which can in turn pop the area zero to give you ray access. And then this will lead to heritage draws, and ray access, of course, gets to engage. And those draws can get you other starters like these, or conversely, these starters can get you the set rotation. So, this deck, the play sequence works both forwards and backwards, so that natural versatility is very, very nice. And the fact that set rotation is just like plus a million is just absolutely absurd. And so, back to the topic at hand, the idea of the quality of your starters, the fact that so many of them plus one, the fact that the sequence is so flexible, is really incredible. And then the third attribute of these starters I want to mention is just the cross-roll functionality. So if you look at a card like Speedroid Terratop in a Burning Abyss deck, a great starter, right? We say a Terratop, Autotop. It's a great starter card. But it's not a bomb in the late game. If you draw a Terratop in the late game, like at the very best, it's fodder. At the very best. But oftentimes, Terratop is just dead in the late game. Just absolutely dead, right? But if you notice these starter cards, like all of these are quality cards to draw later in the game. So with that said, they're not just starters, like they're extenders, they're bombs even. I mean, like all of these can qualify as bombs in a number of different scenarios. So with all that said, I mean, if you just think about how these starters are the right quantity and the right quality in terms of their versatility and their card roll cross functionality, and the card advantage that they generate, and you can already see just looking at that alone, like the ridiculous potential of a deck like this, right? Okay, extenders. So, of course, area zero, like I mentioned, like is the natural follow up to the set rotation combo. And then you can think of these cards as extenders. Let's see, Hornet is certainly one. This is kind of like an extender, it's like a defense. This is defense, but it's also extender of sorts. And then on the long similar lines, these are extenders, but also defense. And so as far as which ones are superior extenders, like these six are definitely so. Probably this one's the seventh one. And then one, two, these six are more like additional extenders, and then these are kind of like cross-categorical. Okay, so, based on, Pat's, philosophy, there's like a certain number of starters and extenders and everything that you want to have, so 3, 6, 9, 12. 12 extenders is a, perfectly reasonable amount of, 13. That's a perfectly reasonable amount of extenders to play. And having them be like half superior, half additional is totally fine as well. And so what you'll find, like where Noah and I diverge in our thinking on the main deck build, like for instance, he doesn't see the value in playing 3-2 instead of 2-3. But this just works more like a superior extender than like an additional extender. And this works more like an additional extender than a superior extender. And that's in most cases, right? Like you have to look at the averages, not, I'm not saying this is true in every last scenario. So for that reason, I just feel like this is just the better card to play a three of. I mean, you want to see it first and last, whereas this one, you usually want to see it somewhere in the middle. And so this covers more scenarios as far as, what happens in a play sequence in over the course of an entire game. Now, What else? So going back to the idea of cross-functionality, right? And I know that I talked about this back when I did my Monarch Burning Abyss profile, which was also a hybrid deck in my 2016 video. A good card is one that can serve across multiple functions, like how all these starters are also bombs, or like how Farfa, Male Branch of the Burning Abyss, is defense, but it's also an extender. And so along similar lines, Like disciples can easily work like a bomb, but it's also like the first card you want to pop, right? So it's the superior center, but it also like works as late as the bomb stage. And then if your hand is really, really bad and you really need to play out of something, like let's say you open like this plus one of these five cards and like no starters, well, there you go. Like you have a combo right there. And so this combination serves as a pseudo starter. And it's like that's like a reason why Burning Abyss was such a good deck, because even if it didn't have a lot of starters, it had so many combinations of superior and additional extenders that turned into Dante that it kind of didn't matter. And so along those same lines, the cross functionality among these cards just really adds value to this deck as a deck choice, and that additionally played a role into like why I chose to play this deck. And then again, like looking at these cards, these are all a form of extenders. But at the same time, they're extenders that that serve the purpose of defense. And so searchable defense, is much preferred to non-searchable defense. All of these cards are searchable. And then the only non-searchable defense is the three Nibiru, and this card is such a blowout that it's worth playing, and it's worth sacrificing game one versus control if you happen to open two copies, which is very rare. I mean, it happened to me at times because this deck, cycles through the card so much, but it's worth that risk because control is by no means the struggle matchup for this deck. So, it's recommended that you play like six defensive cards. So, I mean, I guess you can call these six defensive cards. Categories are really, really fluid, so it's kind of hard to categorize in the modern era of Yu-Gi-Oh, but as best as I can put it, those are kind of like the card rules. And so you see, like, even if the rules themselves are not as neat and clean cut or distinct as with like past decks that I've played or that the community has played, the same fundamentals hold true. Like, there's a certain like a target quantity and a certain attributes that make a quality of a card good. Again, just heavily emphasizing that cross functionality and cards that really increase the cards that you have rather than trade evenly. And then, of course, there's one bomb is multi-role, and obviously just a huge blowout. But what I just love, again, I mean, just to sing the praises of set rotation and why we named the deck after this card is that it's the most amazing starter and also a bomb. Like, that's kind of unfair, Just really, really good deck. So yeah, starters, superior additional extenders, defense, bomb. And there's one additional extender. And it's like, it's like what you colloquially refer to as the Garnet. Or sorry, not additional extender. One, sorry, engine requirement. I'm clearly, out of it. So there's one engine requirement, and yeah, it's a card that you never want to hard draw. But well, I mean, again, back to the topic of unfairness. Even the one engine requirement in this deck is like still like, super good, because if you normal summon a Draco, and then you go into Clara and Bushka in the main phase two, then you just made your Garnet live, and yeah, you didn't just make your Garnet live, you made your Garnet into Pot of Greed, like the best spell ever printed. So, like there you go, right? And then we don't have a category for this card, but Upstart Goblin is we just call it a placeholder card. Pat can correct me if I'm wrong, but from what I remember, there's no other card in this category. But I mean, that's like why this card's at one, right? And arguably should be banned, is because like it's so absurd. Like a card in this role just basically breaks deck building rules. Like all of these cards fit under their respective categories and serve the roles in those categories. But Upstart Goblin is just one of the most game-changing cards ever printed in Yu-Gi-Oh. And like we named our company Parvenu after this card because like it just breaks deck building rules. So we just call it a placeholder, because for lack of a better word, but it's basically its own category. The main deck itself did not change at all between all three events. I was very satisfied with its performance and with its ratios, and based on everything I just discussed, like I think you can understand why I made no changes. So, I mean, it's not that it's like flawless. Like there are certainly contradictions that you don't like. I mean, any deck has contradictions, right? Because if they didn't, then it would just be the most consistent deck ever made. And there might be a couple of decks in the game's history that has no contradictions like that. But every deck has some contradictions, some bad hands. Like drawing the Draco cards by themselves can really suck at times. And so I would love to be able to reduce the number of Draco cards, for instance. But and you certainly can post sideboard. But as far as the main deck, I just there wasn't a single card where I thought like, yeah, I definitely want to always see another card the vast majority of time instead of this card. Yeah, like any other change would have made this like further like less consistent. Like I would love to cut some Draco cards for two more Upstart Goblin, but you know, a guy can dream, right? Okay, so as far as differences between the build across the three tournaments that I played, and I think this will really highlight just the lessons that I've learned along the way, because again, as someone who has to like kind of play under hard mode against the challenge of not actually keeping up with the game, I had to pick a deck that is something that I was familiar with. So an engine that I've played before, which was Draco and Striker. I played both engines separately, just not together. And I had to, you know, kind of learn as I progressed because don't have the availability, you know, the bandwidth to play or talk about or think about this game outside of YCS weekends. So with all that in mind, I had to learn a lot. And so my Niagara build was a lot weaker. So for Niagara, this was in the side for Mega Fleet in the extra deck, and then this was not here. This was second Kaina. But post Niagara, I realized that everyone was playing around the Mega Fleet. But also, Mega Fleet is just like not that much of a conversion card in general. Like when you ask yourself what card you should play in your main extra side, like I think one thing that is heavily under-indexed among players is just asking the question, does this card convert losses to wins? Like so often, players will think about cards that win them games, but that's the wrong question to ask entirely. You know, it's you don't want to ask what wins games. You want to ask what converts would-be losses to wins. And so Mega Fleet, I don't think is a card that really does that. And so I just moved this to the extra deck, and then they make room in the side. And then I saw like second kind of definitely has its uses because double kind of puts in a lot of work against matchups like Thunder or just like combo matchups in general, but it doesn't come up nearly enough to justify it over Dingirsu. Dingirsu was a little bit debatable because it doesn't come up in a ton of scenarios. Like, I would say, I'm not even sure that I summoned it across the two tournaments following Niagara. I don't know if I did, but I do know that there are situations where you're just like, yeah, like, if I don't have Dingirsu in my extra right now, like, I just lose this game. And so going back to what I just said a second ago about picking cards that convert losses to wins. Like, it doesn't matter if I don't summon this much. The fact is that it converts losses to wins. And so you don't want to look at cards that just win games. That's flawed, you know, reasoning. And you don't want to look at cards that you just summon a whole lot. Like, while that intuitively makes sense, frequency of summon by itself paints an incomplete portrait of, you know, what makes a card, you know, essential. And so I'm looking at what converts losses to wins, even if they're like once per tournament cards. I mean, this doesn't really require much explanation. Like, this is, you know, this is classic Skystriker. And as I already mentioned, this turns your Garnet into Pot of Greed, which is, isn't that just like a crazy concept? It turns the worst card in the game into the best card in the game. So this is for Pendulum because, or sorry, yeah. Because Pendulum doesn't always summon two darks, and so you can use their Vortex Dragon to summon that. And so, yeah, going back to the differences. So at Niagara, I had never faced Ludonite Orcus before because, again, as an inactive player, I have only faced what I faced earlier in the year when I was active. So anything new that came out, I was completely oblivious to. And so none of this was in my side at that time. You know, like, it was just the third shared ride and then Predaplant and then three be only one because I figured, well, be only one's a good floodgate. So, and it's performed a lot for me in the past when I played Striker or Draco pure. So I thought it would be a good card to just side as a generic, you know, really good card, side card. But surprisingly, it underperformed. And then there was Afterburners and Eagle Booster, which just, you know, I was advised to side them. Yeah, I really just had to listen to other people because I didn't have the bandwidth to actually, you know, invest in practice of my own accord. So I trusted their wisdom, but unfortunately, in the 10th round, I faced against Ben, and he really decimated me with Lunalight Orcus. I lost the die roll, so it was really a hopeless cause given the side deck that I had at the time. You know, this is, you know, not going to do that much. And then game two. This card is, you know, it's amazing going first against almost every last deck. Like, there's, you can count on one hand how many decks you should not bring this in against going first. But so game two, I opened two copies of this, or I drew, eventually drew into two copies of this. So I had no excuse for losing that game, but I blundered on a very classic mistake in Yu-Gi-Oh! Like, you know, obviously, even low-level players know to play their worst cards first and their best cards last. This is Dimensional Barrier, and so I used this instead of using Widow Anger first. And so because of that, I got punished and lost game two. And so I was really feeling down about that. So I asked Ben, like, just so that I can my conscience can rest easy, can we play a hypothetical game three so that I can see what would have happened? And so he goes first in our hypothetical game three, and he does the standard play to open Eradicator, and I open Super Poly, which if you use it, turn player priority in the draw phase, it gets around Eradicator. I did that, and I still lost because his follow up was just too good. And so that was when I, coming out of Niagara, I realized, okay, like, Lunalight Orcus, you can all disagree with me here, and even I'm personally not sure, but at the time, I thought it's probably the best deck. Even if it isn't, it's definitely the matchup to focus on. And so, what little time I did have to talk about Yu-Gi-Oh! With people, and I have many people like Andrea and Ben and others to thank for this. Like, I sought their input, and I decided what little time I have outside of YCSs to think about Yu-Gi-Oh! I'll just try to figure out how to solve going second against Lunalight Orcus, because, you know, 80-20 rule, when you can't do everything, just focus on the stuff that matters. And so I figured that's the one thing that really matters is winning that matchup. And so those, you know, very mediocre cards that underperformed earlier, I decided to, you know, replace them with these blowout cards. Well, these good cards. So as far as going second in that matchup, no material is the one that really blows them out. So I think one of the things that made Lunalight Orcus good before, you know, the most recent ban list is that, and possibly the best deck, again, I'm not sure, but, you know, potentially, is that the deck has so many different openings that contradicts what hand trap works against them. So a hand that loses to Impermanence might not lose to other hand traps like Ogre, or I don't know, like DD Crow, or Allied Addresses Cycle Reader, or Ash Blossom, or Drolan Lockbird. You know, like, as you can see, I thought through all the options. Artifact Lancia, you know, there's so many options. But the hand trap that works against one hand will not work against the other hand. Now, as a player trying to solve this matchup, that's very frustrating to me. But I'm sure that for players like Ramiro and Ben who played the deck Lunalight Orcus, you know, for them it's a huge boon. You know, it's a tremendous advantage to be able to play a deck that like can work around various hand traps depending on the scenario and depending on your opening cards. And so, to solve that paradox, there's no solution to that paradox, right? So like, there's one card that works categorically across, you know, all their hands, and that's no material. So that one was a shoo-in for, you know, changes to the deck. Like, definitely playing these three, but I can't guarantee that I'll draw them, right? And I have to open a hand trap, or else I lose. You know, like if I can't play, I lose. So like, I mean, like, if I can't stop Eradicator or Imperial Order, I lose. This was categorically right. So this was the only card that wasn't like susceptible to the paradox of the Lunalight Orcus hands, so this one is a must include. But then after that, we deliberated, you know, over what was second best, and it was just so debatable. But after, like, you know, much conferring with peers, I feel like Impermanence was the next best answer. And you know, you're welcome to disagree with me, but I think at the end of the day, for a deck that plays 26 spells, you have to index the ability to stop Imperial Order very, very highly. Stopping things like the Orcus combo with like a card like Lancia comes secondary to stopping Imperial Order, right? Because if you can't play, then you can do nothing. So the goal is not to like stop them from playing. The goal is to stop yourself from getting locked by Imperial Order. Ideally, I would love to have played like another three preventative hand trap, but just I don't think that anything was good enough, so I went with three Super Poly. And it still performed decently, and it's, and as many of you out there are aware, it's good in other matchups. And then between Guadalajara and Fort Worth, I just got really embarrassed by the fact that I didn't own a third copy of this in French Secret, so I switched to Ghost Ogre. No, I'm just kidding. I don't own a third copy in French Secret, so please let me know if you have one that you can sell or trade to me. But the reason I switched this is I found that like the number of cards I could take out in this matchup going second against Lunalight Orcist was greater than 9 at times. There's potentially 10 cards to take out. In the 10th card, I think it is the third Area Zero. I'm not sure, but I think it is based on my limited experience. And so Area Zero is a very, very good card, don't get me wrong. And having two in deck does put you at risk of set rotation not being live at times. But I figured that risk was worth having a 10th card to help you get through their, prevent Imperial Order. Because at the end of the day, like, that's so important. If you can play, then you can win. But if you can't play, then you have no chance of winning. So you have to be able to enable yourself to play. So why Ogre, right? My reasoning was Ogre can stop Nyarla, which lets you potentially Nibiru afterward. If they're the type of player to gun Nyarla, Ogre can stop a number of their other plays. It can prevent Imperial Order. But my other reasoning was that because you take out three Nibiru against all control decks, and you only have two cards to side in against control, you need a card that can be the 10th against combo, but also the third against control. And so I think the options really are just, I don't know, like Drolan Lockbird or Ogre. And I figured Ogre was probably the better card. But of course, one tree does not make a forest. And so my Fort Worth experience, I don't think I ever resolved this to my recollection. So, one tournament did not provide enough data to really make any sort of meaningful conclusion about whether this was the right choice. And the format's over anyway, so I'm not gonna, scratch my head over, what was correct. So that's kind of a summary of how this deck progressed in its shape. Yeah, so I was just overall very satisfied with the main deck enough to not have to change that. And so, as you can see, the side deck evolved as my understanding of the metagame evolved. And I was subsequently rewarded for that. And it was actually very poetic what happened because after my defeat at the hands of Ben on the bubble at Niagara, I received advice and input and made the appropriate adjustments. And then I ended up, I think, winning 4 out of 5 of my next matches against Lunalight Orcus in tournament. My only other loss was, I think, in top cut at Guadalajara. But anyway, it was really poetic, Guadalajara, because the 10th round of that tournament on the bubble, again, I'm X2, and I face none other than Lunalight Orcus again, and I lose the die roll again. I keep losing the rolls in that matchup. But I was able to pull through and actually 2-0 my opponent because he, well, it was a combination of things, but the adjustments, certainly paid off. And so, I mean, when it comes to having the limited resource of time, you can only focus on so much. You don't have time to practice. You don't have time to think about the game. You only have a few conversations about the game. Then you pick what your biggest pain point is and just focus on addressing and solving that. And so that kind of concludes the deck profile section. Oh, actually, well, maybe we can just take a few more moments just to talk a bit about siding. So I know that I didn't discuss siding in past articles or videos, so that's probably a blind spot as far as content that I've covered in my work. And then on top of that, I think that oversiding might be one of the biggest mistakes that people make in their deck building, or siding the wrong cards. And so, just quick thoughts on siding. With some exception, you don't set out starters. So in this deck, I would not set out starters, because everything I just said about how ridiculously unfair the starter cards are in this deck. Like, I would not set out the starter cards. You can set out cards that underperform and serve peripheral roles. So when I did the second, iteration of this deck profile just now, where I divvied up cards by their role, you probably noticed that there was just a lot of defense. And so you can definitely go down on defense. Like, I would very regularly side out a Widow Anchor. And you can do these two defensive cards. You can certainly do this. As counterintuitive as it sounds, this isn't actually the best card against a Lunalight Orcus or maybe other Orcus builds as well. The third Ignis is, really bad going first. And yeah, I mean, like, I play it, and like, so is the Third Disciples. Like, I play them because there just strictly isn't a better card that is across the board preferred over these engine cards. So you can't change the main, but at the very best, you can just side it out a whole lot, both first and second, to be honest. Unless you're facing like control decks or decks that get punished heavily by Ignis. You can side out the can side out multi-role. No, I'm just kidding. Never side that out. Just kidding. One area zero, like I mentioned, can be the 10th card that you take out. Nibirus can be sided out for sure, especially if you see them gunning for Azathoth. Do not side this out. I mean, like, unless you're about to play in time. And what else? Oh yeah, so I mean, just a really quick aside about cross functionality. So Ray is kind of like an additional extender because set rotation and also just hard drawing area zero. There's like just a number of ways to get to Ray after spending your normal summon. And so it's just really cool that Ray is not only a ridiculously good starter, but also a great follow-up and also an additional extender. But the reason that you play two is not just because it serves more of an additional extender role in this deck compared to more of a starter role in a pure Sky Striker deck, but it's also because there's a very, like, I guess, under-discussed principle in deck building. Like, apart from like the ratios of 11 to 14 starters and like 12 or 13 however many extenders and one engine requirement and at most three bombs and six defense and all those ratios that are important. One that gets under-discussed is that you should not have more than three hard normal summons. Basically, if you go above three, barring just exceptional circumstances, it just creates a lot of problems in your deck. There are exceptions, but they're very exceptional, to kind of speak redundantly. Like pure Orcist is an exception, just to use one example. So yeah, when it comes to siding, you don't want to overside, but in matchups where if you play, you win, then you do side heavily. So the current format, I say current, but I mean last format because it's a new format now. But the most recent format, the example would be Lunalight Orcus, where you side 10 cards, and it's not oversiding because in that matchup, you have to play to win. But to use a more classic example, think about Dragon Ruler versus Spellbook, right? Dragon Ruler was, at least at the time, considered the better deck. It's certainly the bigger deck, like in terms of who's the beatdown. You can debate all you want about, in hindsight, what deck is actually the better deck. But for its time, Dragon Ruler was like the bigger deck, the better deck against Spellbook. So you would think, being the better deck, that it should side less against Spellbook than Spellbook sides against it. But actually, Dragon Ruler would side, as many as 10 or more cards against Spellbook because in that matchup, if you play, you win. And their only win condition against you is to keep you from playing. It's not through any other means normally. So that's what I have to say about siding is side heavily if you need to play to win, but side sparingly and err on the side of undersiding rather than oversiding if that's not the case. Because I understand when you're not new to the game, but I mean, when you're just like kind of a developing player, the temptation to see every last scenario where this or that card might work. Like, oh yeah, maybe there is a situation where Cosmic Cyclone can banish Lunalight Tiger or Imperial Order, and so that will tempt you to play it, right? Or like Cosmic Cyclone can banish multi-role, so I should play it, right? That's not really the right way to think about it, because everything in your side, you can justify bringing it in if you can think of the scenarios where it's valuable. But that's the kind of thinking that leads to oversiding. So, be cautious about that. Side only what is absolutely essential. Side the cards that are categorically better than the cards that are they're replacing, with the exception of the matchups where you have to play to be able to win. Okay, so that concludes the deck building portion. And so moving on from that, I guess we'll go ahead and go into a time of theory now.
Okay, so I'm gonna go ahead and go into like the theory portion now. This is geared toward you know, more developing players. So if you're brand new to Yu-Gi-Oh, or if you you know, follow the game casually, or just came back, you might not extract as quite as much value, but I don't know, like maybe it'll still be valuable. But also, if you're a very, very seasoned veteran of the game, you also just, some of this might sound repetitive, but I mean, but in any case, I hope that my insights can provide you know, some degree of value add to the majority of the audience out there. So I guess like where I want to start, and there's going to be some overlap with past content, including my 1 hour deck profile video, is just on those dimensions of the game that we discussed before, like in Road of the King. So, well, I guess, okay, let's start with this. So there's why, there's how, and there's what, right? So when, you know, doing anything in life, there's like kind of three things you ask yourself when deciding on whether to do it or how to go about executing it. You ask yourself why, you know, why do you do it? Like, why do you play Yu-Gi-Oh? You know, like for some of us, we love the camaraderie. For some of us, we love the travel. For some of us, you know, we love that sensation of winning. We love the self-improvement factor. We love the math, you know, whatever it is, you know, you gotta know your why. Because that's gonna drive how you approach the game. It's gonna drive, you know, your work ethic and all those other things. After that is how. How is, you know, your methodology, and then what is what specific strategy that you actually choose. And so, you know, this is a philosophical discussion, why, so we're like, we won't get into that. You know, we all play this game for different reasons. I would just say that if you have a strong why, then that will inherently lead to a better performance across time. So, you know, make sure you develop your why really well to be able to perform at this game or whatever it is that you do in life. And then as far as how and what, I really like to distill down competition into these two categories because I feel like they succinctly capture everything there is to competition, no matter the sport, no matter the game. You know, be it Yu-Gi-Oh or Warfare or soccer or anything else, how and what kind of encapsulates all the decisions you need to make and all the skill sets you need. Just two categories, really, how and what. And so we call them different things. We call them by different names and in different art forms. So like in violin, for instance, how is like technique, I guess, and then, or yeah, kind of. And then what is like what you choose to play, your musicality, that kind of thing. But anyway, bringing it back to home, how in Yu-Gi-Oh is technical play, and what is deck building, right? And so we take these two categories, and we can just kind of chop up this like 2x2 matrix, right? Me and them. So there's me, there's them, there's how, there's what, and then together that makes this, you know, very simple matrix. So for This is how I play my cards, right? So my how is technical play. It's just, you know, the sequence of cards that I play, and if there's time, I'm going to kind of do a deep dive into tech play because there's so much to say on the matter, and tech play is very significant. I think the community often debates how significant it is, but it is very significant. Okay, and then my what is deck building. So, you know, what strategy you choose, right? And we can call this something else in a different game or different sport. So in chess, we wouldn't call it deck building. We call it like, you know, which gambit that you open with, or, you know, what opening do you do? You know, what style, and I don't know what you call tech play in chess, but you know, you get the idea, like technique, how you move your pieces. Okay, and then the lesser but still important category or variance of these two things for them, which is your opponent or the field, is for tech play, it's, for lack of a better word, we just call it Jedi tricks. And I'll get into that. And then the what for other people is their choice of cards, right? So the inverse of deck building. And we'll just call it metagaming. Okay. So, you know, across these axes, we have the four fundamental actions or strategies or skill sets. you know, for Yu-Gi-Oh, there's the deck you choose, the cards your opponent chooses, there's how you play your cards, there's how your opponent plays your cards. And back in Pat's era of dominance, you know, he argued that this was everything, and it was certainly the case because back then, right, we didn't have those card rules yet. I mean, Pat had them, but nobody else had them. So only Pat's circle could benefit from, you know, playing the true ratios that decks ought to have, right? And also, I think players were just worse back then due to like limited technology or limited viewpoints and, you know, less history to work off of. That, you know, back then, for all those factors I just named, deck building had a higher index. It definitely provided more value relative to technical play when it came to the highest levels of play. Now, I'm not talking about low levels like locals, regionals, what have you. You can play standard, top of regional, top of YCS, sure. But as far as, you know, when you get to the level where everyone's playing more or less perfectly, you know, what can you do to differentiate yourself and gain an advantage? And one might say Jedi tricks, sure, but those are marginal advantages, you know, like looking for 10x advantages, not 10% advantages. And so during that era, you know, 2013, and then the years that followed, this was definitely at its peak index. But as far as today goes, it's highly debatable, you know, what matters more or less. So I actually don't know what the following numbers I'm about to write are gonna sum up to, but I just thought like it would be cool to do a little exercise in real time where I go through my rounds from these three YCSs. So that's 10 rounds of Swiss times 3 plus an 11th round in Fort Worth is 31. And then a round of Top Cut from Guadalajara is 32. And then 3 rounds of Top Cut from Fort Worth is 35. So let's take 35 data points and just look at, you know, from my limited experience this past month, you know, how important these factors stack into victory. So YCS Niagara. You know, first round I faced Ancient Gear, so you know that's a casual player, so I won that off of deck building, right? Okay, so second round I faced Endymion Pendulum Zephra. I lost to I don't know. I could say it was an unfavorable matchup, but there was also a moment where I could have made a read. I saw him check a face down. And I figured, okay, if he's checking it, then it must be the counter trap. But I also didn't know how good he was. Like, I didn't know if he was experienced enough to be the kind of player who would fake check a card like that to telegraph the Zephra Divine Strike that he searched. And so I didn't want to overestimate his skill or underestimate his skill and then get punished for misreading how intelligent he was, right? So in the end, it ended up being the counter trap. And so as an aside, it's typically correct to assume that players are average and think average. And so if they check a card, you should take that at face value. But I didn't want to, in the moment, I didn't want to risk it. So I rolled a die to see which card to pop with like disciples or something. and I popped not Divine Strike, and so arguably that could have taken me to victory. So I would say I lost round two to Jedi Tricks. I don't know. Just like my failure to adequately assess my opponent's skill level when it came to tech play. Okay, so round three of Niagara was against True Draco. So the Monarch Subrupt build. So you're supposed to 2-0 that deck in every single time. Just the inherent matchup is, you know, a deck advantage. I mean, I guess the only time you don't 2-0 it is if you open multiple Nibiru, which I think may have happened to me at some point. Okay, round four was Pendulum Zephra. I won that one. Okay. So round four was interesting. Let's see. Oh, no, sorry. I'll get to that later. So it was round four, I won. I would say that my opponent, and he wasn't wrong for this, but he blindsided Lancia against me. I forgot why he blindsided it. Okay, but in any case, I played that fairly regularly. I think he had the deck advantage. I'll chalk that one up to technical play, because in terms of like soft mistakes, I guess you could argue that he committed one and I committed zero. So that's four rounds. Okay, fifth round, Dinosaur Shadal, so that's just an inherent deck advantage, right? Sixth round was Zephra Pendulum again, and so that was the one where I asked him how many cards he mained, and he said 44. And then knowing that total, as well as watching him play and what cards he ran, it gave me the sense that his deck is probably not the most consistent Pendulum deck, so game three, I put him on first. And I got a reward for it because he sided in Pinker Tops. And I would have done so if he played 40 cards, but he played 44. So that one was a matter of metagame, I would say. round seven, I faced Erupt Draco again. So that one was game three, so it was probably the game where I opened multiple Nibiru. And then round eight, I faced Pure Cyber Dragon, and so that's just an inherent deck advantage. Okay. All right, so on to Niagara Day 2, round 9. I faced, Colin Bradshaw, Orcus Cyber Dragon. So that one, I messed up. I mean, it was a very, very improbable scenario. Like, I had to open too few cards to play in time. And he had to get a slow play warning to even take us that far in the game to begin with. And he had to open, I opened Nibiru, but he had to open the perfect hand to get around Nibiru, which was Cyber Dragon core and machine duplication. But as it just so happened, all those stars aligned for him. And then on top of that, I committed a very slight error. So I had the only one in my side deck still for that event. And I decided to side it out for that third game because I didn't want to overside. But I learned after the match, after I thought about it after the match, I realized that you have to change your side deck rules in time, because the same ratios that will mess up your engine over a long drawn out game may very well be the ratios that keep your life points safe in a secluded, narrow game of one turn. So with that said, I would say that was a deck building error on my part for not leaving in, basically not oversighting intentionally. So yeah, I did get unlucky, but that match came down to a deck building error on my part. So I came literally 2 seconds within topping Niagara. So that's why I say that it was nearly a 3-peat in YCS Tops. Okay, so and then round 10, I lost to Ben, and so I lost that one to his inherent deck advantage. Well, arguably, I didn't metagame properly, so you could chalk it up to that. But yeah, I would say the same thing. I just didn't know that matchup, and so my deck was not built appropriately for the event. All right, so YCS Guadalajara, round one I played Striker and I lost. This matchup is free for my deck, but the problem is that that event, I think it was a combination of not having enough experience as well as I had like taken an accounting quiz the night before and I just was so focused on school, so I couldn't really think about Yu-Gi-Oh, so I was not warmed up at all for round one. So I lost the Striker and I'm pretty sure it was a tech play error because I had a hand in game two, or what was game two? Yeah, T2O'd me, so I had a hand in game two where I opened two shared ride and I decided not to pop one of them with Iram, and I popped a Widow Anchor instead, not acknowledging that Widow Anchor is basically ray access in the mirror, which I know sounds very simple when I say it out loud, but in the moment, you know, two shared ride to be able to skip this turn twice just sounded really good in my head. So that was my mistake. Round two, I faced Cyber Dragon Orcus, and basically, I did a battle phase trick on him to get him to kind of kill himself. And then round three is Jose Flores, Striker in here again. I lost, but after that round three in Guadalajara, I never lost a single game even to Striker, like not just a match, but a game to Striker again. Like I just, you know, saw enough of the matchup to figure out the pattern and like kind of get an idea of like what I'm supposed to do each time. So I lost that to my inexperience. Yeah, I think he also got a little bit lucky because he by no means played, he did not play better than me. I could have played better still. Round four, Dragon Link. So, you know, deck building, like Dragon Link is just, you know, not gonna win. All right, round five, I faced Hero, which yeah, you never lose to, so deck building. And that matchup was really funny because game one, I was like, I did a long combo, battle phase. Main phase two, I like finished my sequence, and as I'm doing my sequence, he calls for a judge, and this is Mexico, so like they speak in Spanish. And so he starts speaking to the judge in Spanish, and I'm like, what is he going on about? And it turns out, the judge translates for me, and the judge tells me that my opponent was asking him whether or not Giant Card was still open for signups, because my opponent was gonna drop. So my opponent dropped in the middle of my sequence, which is the funniest thing I've ever encountered. No, it's not, but it was funny. Round six, Lunar Light Orcist, I lost the roll, but you know, this time I was prepared, and I was ready for him, so yeah, metagaming. Or no, I'm sorry. That's not metagaming. My fault. That's working around what your opponents do. Is it metagaming? Is it deck building? No, it's metagaming.
Alright, I got it.
Okay. Round seven. I face Subterror. Never, ever, ever, ever lose a match to Subterror, like, ever. Just deck advantage. Okay. Alright, so moving on to day two of Guadalajara. Playing on the bubble, X2, gotta win out 3-0. This round was funny. So it's round eight, right? And I get paired against a player with a custom Sky Striker mat, and he has a Sky Striker token, and his record has three draws instead of two losses. So I think Striker, right? Three draws, Striker mat, Striker token. And it was Orcus, so yeah, I faced Orcus. That threw me for a loop. I won that one, and I don't remember that match too well, but I mean, on the whole, if I had to pin it toward anything, I would say that I don't know if you really have a deck matchup. I would just say that I probably just played that correctly. Round nine, Salamon Great. I mean, just inherent advantage, just really, really strong. I mean, he took game one off me just because he won the roll and opened like their most perfect opening. But besides that, I just this inherent matchup advantage. And also, he ended up getting a game loss because it's a long story, but basically he was able to like run out the clock through utilizing the language barrier. So I want that's a deck advantage, but I will say that like it serves as a good illustration for the importance of player management. You like, especially when you're in a foreign country, like you have to be able to clearly communicate to the judge and the head judge like what happened, present your story, like know your rights, know how to appeal, know the policy, or else you're just gonna get taken advantage of. You know, I can easily see someone who's just not as experienced, you know, just not recognizing that situation, what's going on, and then just taking loss and just being like, oh, I would have won in time, but I just didn't get there, and then you don't talk, you know, like those little things make or break it. And so by being able to, you know, fight for what I deserved and tell the head judge like, hey, like this guy is using the language barrier against me. He's lying about his game state and changing his story up. And after investigation, my story was corroborated and they gave him the game loss. And so player management is just really important. I don't think that you can do well consistently without having a good player management skill set. Okay, and then round 10 was Luna Orcus. This was an American, and again, I lost the role, but I pulled through. And I really like round 10. It was a huge redemption arc for me because I just had just previously lost to the same deck going second on the bubble in the previous event. But this event, there was this clutch moment where he summons Ningirsu and I have two cards on the field and I'm in a very poor position because of Imperial Order lock. And so he can send my face down card or he can send my Ray to grave. And so I like do this mind game where I basically, through the motion of my hands, kind of suggest to him that I think he's going to send Ray and that I want him to. And like it causes him to doubt himself and question, you know, whether it's the right play. And I would have to go back in the match and really look at what happened to determine whether or not it was right to send Ray. But either way, like I just had to do what I could to encourage him to think that I wanted Ray sent to grave, when in fact I wanted my set card sent to grave. So he second guesses himself based on my actions, sends the cycle to the grave, it pops his Imperial Order, and so Imperial gets destroyed and I'm able to play, and I have like a blowout hand of like, you know, triple engage, multi-roll and all that stuff, like just amassed and just ready to blow him out. But it all hinged on tricking him into sending disciples to grave. So, really good match. Like I'm super satisfied with how I played that because I couldn't get, well that was just game one. So I like even if I had failed, there was still game three and all that. But nevertheless, I'm really satisfied with just the trick that I pulled off in order to win on the bubble and get into top cut. So moving on, and then Top Cut was just a disaster. I mean, he 2-0'd me, solid player, and he won the roll again. So yeah, I just kept losing the die roll to Luna Light Orcus. And so he won that through the inherent deck advantage, going first. Appaloosa, too strong. Okay, YCS Fort Worth. So round one, I faced this guy who looks like a Gabriel Vargas, actually, but it wasn't Gabe. Gabe is cuter, but so I faced this guy, and he's playing Solomon Gray, and to be honest, I really, really should have won. Like, I was going to 3-0 him, 3-0, but I had, like, infinite card advantage on him, and then because I don't, like, keep up with the game and all that, like, it's been so long since I faced against Fusion of Fire. And so, with his few remaining cards in hand, he went for a Fusion of Fire Hail Mary play. And I made the mistake of, well, I made a two-sided mistake. One was I had so much card advantage that I actually filled my back row up and locked myself out with a Dynamite because I just had too much card advantage. I should have left that spot open and not been so greedy by filling it with Disciples just for that one extra draw, you know. And so, because that spot was filled, I could not use Dynamite's effect to get Apocalypse to prevent an OTK. But then on the other hand, there was still a way for me to win with Ray's effect, triggering off of Fusion of Fire's effect. And I don't know, it wasn't until four rounds later that I saw that mistake. I don't know why I didn't see it. I guess I just again, I haven't seen that situation in a very, very long time. So yeah, we had a draw due to my tech play error, but I was gonna 3-0 the guy. Like, it really was, like, none of our games were close. We just didn't get to game 3. Round 2. Dragon Link, so again, that's an automatic win. Round 3. Striker. And so that was deck advantage, but I will say, though, that, like, just being able to play that matchup really well after my losses in Guadalajara is how I got to a point where I just started to 2-0 all my striker opponents. Like, it's such a convoluted and nuanced matchup. There's just so many plays that go on. So yeah, you gotta figure out the right, you know, line of play. So tech play does matter a lot there, but I would chalk it up to tech building advantage. Round 4, Altergeist. This was so dumb. So this was my only loss in Swiss. I got 2-0'd by Geist. I couldn't play either game because he had Imperial Order game 1. And then game 2, he had Imperial Order plus Heavy Storm Duster to out my out to Imperial Order. So, what did he win with that one? So it's what he does. So I lost to him metagaming the fact that Imperial Order is a really hot card right now that addresses a lot of decks. So that was metagaming. Round 5, Lunalight Orcus. I lost a roll again, but I played better with 9 points. That was 10 play. So I game 2, he's really afraid that I'll open a hand trap, which, of course, statistically speaking, I will. But I faced, like, the 20%, 22% scenario where I open all engine, despite having, you know, so many hand traps. And then he only opens 2 dangers, and he decides not to go for it, which was just really foolish in my perspective, because yes, you probably will get stopped by a hand trap, but you have to try it. Like, if you just summon dangers, like, you'll lose. So yeah, I don't know what's going on there. Round 6 in Demeon. So this round was interesting because game 2, he sided before he decided whether or not he would choose first or second, and he visibly showed that in his like facial expression and in his words and his indecisiveness really showed. And because you couldn't conceal his emotions, I could mentally tick off, you know, what cards are in his deck for that game, right? Like, if he hasn't decided, then obviously there's no Denkoseka in his deck that game. Unless he's just next level, which, if he were, I would have some inkling of that game 1 based on seeing how he played. But he played very substandard game 1. So, I mean, on the whole, like, it was a matter of playing correctly and also being able to read what was going on based on his emotions. So that was tech play. It's not Jedi trick because I'm not really doing anything with his play, but there is a little bit of Jedi in there because I'm taking advantage of the fact that his emotions are showing. Round 7 was Sky Striker, another 2-0. Now I'll give one the tech play this time. I think I played that really well, but then on top of that, it's just I don't think every striker match should go here because it does deserve like if I could assign partial points, I would, because striker is just a very, very, very technical matchup. Like, yes, I have the deck advantage, but you without technique, you're not going to get there. Striker is still like a huge threat pre ban list. Round 8, striker 2-0'd. So let's give this one deck building. All right, and then that led us to the last round of day 1, which was True Draco, and it was such a relief to face a freebie at the end of day 1. So True Draco, easy. Okay, day 2, round 10, I faced Angel Asensio. So he actually won the first event that I topped, So I knew that he was like an experienced and seasoned player. And then on top of that, on the news coverage site, it said what deck he was playing. So, you know, like I knew what was going on going in. And I was a little bit nervous because I know that Gogi Orcus can be really scary. Like, it generates so much card advantage game one. But game one, he made a play out of habit where he discarded his Divine Phoenix Blade, I think, instead of his Simple Skeleton from hand. Like, just out of habit. You know, like, when you do something so many times, like, you just do it mindlessly. So he did it out of habit, not acknowledging that with his particular hand, like, the only way to finish the combo is to discard Simple Skeleton. And so based on the way his combo didn't finish, I was like, oh, he has Simple Skeleton in hand. I took advantage of that and stole that game. Game two, he just blows me out with Boreal Sword OTK. Then game three, okay, so game three, I had a commanding lead. Like, I was gonna win apart from time, but I ended up winning in time by life points, and he actually had a way to steal it from me that he didn't see until after the game finished. But basically, he summoned Pickertops, and I impermanence it, but he chains Pickertops' effect to impermanence to destroy Ignis. And if he had kept Pinkertops, he would have done like just enough damage to close the deficit, which would have allowed him to steal the game in time, which would have been fair for him because I stole the game from him in game one because of misplays. He kind of stole the game from me from time. But again, like, this is the same type of error, right? So just like in game one, he is chaining Pinkertops to impermanence out of habit. Like this is a textbook correct play. So, you know, why not do it? But if you have infinite time, then you can like run the whole sequence of the turn in your head and play it all out and realize that, oh, the math doesn't add up. Like, if you do that play, which is textbook correct, it's a better play for winning the match, but it makes you lose some time. And so he lost some time. And so with both of those errors, I think it's a good time to kind of make the point that to really excel at something, it's first you have to get the foundation right. You know, the thing that you have to do 99% of the time, like, you need to do it right 99% of the time. But then I think what characterizes a true expert is someone who can recognize when that 1% is, when they can break habit and consciously decide to, you know, do the counterintuitive play because the situation calls for it. So recognizing that situation is I think what distinguishes, you know, excellent players from just good players, which is not to say that, you know, Angel is a bad player. Like, he may very well be really good and just messed up that time, because the bubble can, you know, produce a lot of nerves. So for that one, it was how my opponent played. And so I didn't Jedi trick him or anything, but, you know, like, his tech play is how he lost that one. Or actually, hold on. No, that's not Jedi. It's his play, but I didn't control his play. So I only controlled my play. So it's the fact that my tech play was better than his. Not that I affected his tech play. Okay. And then round 11, I faced a person from my old local in Houston, Jason. And so that one was just like, you know, dead advantage. It's like 2-0 with like, you know, more than 10 minutes on the clock. And I know that Jason was really excited about getting his first top potentially, but like it would have been cool if like there was a way for us to both make it. But, you know, it doesn't sit right with me as a player to like try anything, you know, underhanded to get there. And and the game just like wasn't close to time anyway, so there wasn't really a way. But, and I'm not gonna name names, but like, there was a table right next, like within my vicinity, where I feel like I did witness an intentional draw. But no, that's not my business. But just saying that it happens and I witnessed it. Okay, top 32, Brendan Beckman, Lunalight Orcus. I finally win a die roll for once against this matchup. So that's nice, you know, finally. And then this was like a redemption arc from top 32 at Guadalajara, because this time I won. I won the die roll, and I opened the best I opened like all weekend. Oh, I just a quick comment. Angel was the only player to take me to game three in all of Swiss. But yeah, I'm particularly proud about the fact that I 2-0'd all my opponents. Okay, yeah, but Brendan, I opened the best that I opened all tournament against him, like just like a standard 13 card opening. You end with like a card of six cards in hand, two of which are engaged. Five cards set is 11. Shizuku on the field is 12, and then diagram is 13. So 13 card opening, it happens quite a bit. But I opened that going first, which is great. And then game two, like I get lucky on some danger snipes, but I also got unlucky in that I didn't open a hand trap against him. So you could look at it, you know, whatever way you want. Like, sure, you could say that he got unlucky, but you could also say that his bad luck canceled out my bad luck. So there's always two sides to every story. In any case, on the whole, I was super ready for him, and yeah, I mean, I feel like I just had a stronger deck, and that took advantage of the fact that I went first with it. Top 16 was Christian. So this one, again, like, Striker 2-0, and it was certainly a matter of just deck advantage. Like, that just shined throughout our match. Like, game one was a huge matter of just, like, keep up for him. You know, Striker likes to do this thing where they keep everything in hand, and, like, I'll certainly say that Christian, he played that exceptionally well. Just seeing how conservative he was in the first, in the opening moves, really differentiated himself from other Striker players that I've faced, and so, you know, it was very obvious why Christian made a top cut. He was playing very conservatively, and then, like, was just ready to, like, you know, blow his hand on, like, the one push for game. But I knew that that's what he was doing, because that's how Striker wins, and so I made sure to make a counterplay to survive that one giant push. And so, yeah, apart from that, I mean, it was like game one was very drawn out, but the entire time, like, I was just ready for when he was gonna go for it. Like, I didn't know when, but I knew at some point he was gonna try, and I knew all I had to do was just survive that attempt, and then after that, I would just win from attrition, basically, especially after they resolved desires, which he did. So, like, there, it just really expedites the attrition like effect after they go for the game push. So it was a very long game, and we had additional minutes to play because of being deck checked. Like, we had like 2 extra minutes than normal, but we went to time anyway. So game two, was definitely deck advantage, because when time is running out, Striker can only hit so hard compared to like Draco monsters, right? And so I got in a very clean 2800 hit with Dynamite, and then a 1500 hit with a Striker monster, whereas he got it in a 1500 hit with Shizuku. And then on top of that, I just opened so broken. So, like, we take turns exchanging shared ride for shared ride, and then on my last turn, he flips shared ride, but, like, my hand is so good that I can just go for game, but like, time is just, like, runs out. So, like, in main phase, I'm like, doing the gameplay, but the sequence requires so many searches that I just, you know, can't even finish it in time for battle phase. But if, like, the game had continued, like, let's say hypothetically we get like a 2-minute time extension, then I would do the same play and go for battle phase. Well, I'll pop a few phase downs first. Like, I think it was all of them. I can't remember if he had 3 or 2 set, but if it was 2 set, I could probably pop both of them and safely go for a game push with Widow Anchor, and then take his last defense and then just attack for game. Like, unless he played like Phantasme, but I saw his deck list and I don't think he played Phantasme. Like, he would need to like Phantasme to like survive, right? And so I would have gone for a game push if we had like a 2-minute extension, just hypothetically speaking. And then if we had an infinite time extension, then I would not have gone for a game. And the reason is because I had a more guaranteed game. And when I say more guaranteed, like, I'm not talking about like a huge gap. Like, I'm talking about like 90% versus 100% later. So like we're talking about small margins here, but you know, if there's something you can do to give yourself a 10% higher chance of winning that game, then you do it. So if we had an infinite time extension, then I would not search on her shared ride, and I would, you know, just set shared ride on his turn, skip his turn with shared ride. And even if he has Ash, well, it's like, if he doesn't have Ash, then he has to skip his turn. If he does have Ash, then that's one less card, and he's already like way lower than me on resources, and so he's certainly not going to kill me. So I don't know like what he would do. Build a little bit of advantage, perhaps, but then, you know, eventually I just take it from there because I have set rotation in hand, and just a greater inevitability. Anyways, the reason I went through that so thoroughly though is that like after the conclusion of that game, like I tell that he was just very frustrated. And, you know, I have respect for him, and, you know, I think it was just an emotional moment. But he was, like, just really just felt that, you know, time was, like, the nail in the coffin for him. But, and so, like, I kind of just went over all that just to say that, you know, like, I had contingency plans to win, given the clock, to win if there were an extension, hypothetically, and also to win in a more guaranteed way if there were infinite time. And so there really was no scenario where he was taking that game, and so it was a clean 2-0. But like in the moment, it was just tough, like seeing him like angry at me, because it was just one of those things where he's like, you know, what can you do about that? You know, like if someone's mad at you, they're mad at you, and you know, the best you can do is just defend yourself, but. At the end of the day, like people are going to react the way that they react, and again, you know, I have all the respect in the world for him. Yeah, I think it was just a very emotional moment to be losing in top cut like that, and I get it. So, yeah. And then, as far as my own demise, the second last player all tournament to take me to game three is Raf, and I face him. He makes me go first game one. And thankfully, I have the ridiculous combo to destroy him. Game two, he makes me go first, and he Boral Sword OTKs me. In game three, I committed two potential errors on top of opening a brick hand. I opened a brick hand, but I also potentially sided incorrectly. But I also, we discussed it after the match, and he says that I should have made him go first. Game three. What would have happened if I did things differently? I don't know. Well, if the luck were held constant, I still draw that brick hand, just one extra card that wouldn't help me. So I still brick if I go second, which is super rare, but it is what it is. But what would happen hypothetically if we had a game three where I could draw a fresh hand and side differently and make him go first? I don't know. I could be a YCS champion for all I know. I don't. And it's... Does it bother me to think about that that could have been? A little bit. But in the end, there were certainly things I could have done better, arguably. So I lost to brick hand, bad luck, so you can call that deck building, on one hand, but there was more that I could do, so deck play. Now, covered the matches. Look at the outcomes. We have 10, we have 3, we have 19. Does that sum correctly? So 6 plus 19 is 25, 35, right? So 3 out of 35, it's like a 1 in 11. Right, it's 1 in 12, so it's like 8%? 8%? And then 10 out of 35 is 1 in 3.5. It's like under 32%. It's like 30%. So 38, 8, 46. This is roughly 54%. Okay. So if we look at the outcomes, I would say between both wins and losses, 54% came from deck advantage, deck building, deck like card choices. 30% from playing better. Or just like not messing up, just like playing clean. 8% from getting my opponent to do the wrong play. 8% to just, yeah, like having, like it's like my opponent's deck building, right? So yeah, I mean, like even in this modern era, I mean, based on my free tournament experiences, the data shows that deck building still is the dominant, you know, factor when it comes to what, you know, wins in Yu-Gi-Oh. But that's not to say that tech play isn't important, because any one of those tops, I was on the bubble, and there's this razor thin margin where if you come in error, you don't top. And so the numbers are useful to know, but it's not to overshadow the point that this is so crucial too, though. You mess up on this, even though it's a minority factor, you don't top. These two, predictably, are just not as big, but you know, still significant. Again, like if you mess up on this stuff, you don't top. And so it's interesting because like this adds up to almost 20. This adds up to, these two add up to roughly 80. And so together we have the 80-20 principle, the Pareto, right? Which is that 20% of the causes are responsible for 80% of the outcomes. And so the vast majority of your time then ought to be devoted to working on this stuff. But this stuff still matters, because why did I bubble Niagara but top Guadalajara and Fort Worth? Because I adapted to my loss on the bubble. I metagamed against Luna Light Orcus going second. So that covers my tournament rounds, and if I could make a point there, it's that, you know, everything matters. Some things determine much, you know, far more matches, but everything is critical. And then on top of those four dimensions, just player management, which is a type of technical play maybe, is also just really important. So yeah, let's redraw that matrix. There's, I mean, I'll just use shorthand, deck, tech play, metagaming, and let's say just mind. Okay. So, right, me, them, and so I wanted to cover something significant from, you know, each one of these dimensions, and hit, you know, just hit every point on the matrix in this lesson. So I talk a lot about deck. You know, why did I choose this deck? And so even if the deck to play is no longer Draco Striker, there's still some lessons to be extracted from that decision, right? So the right ratios, you know, like, you know, right number of starters, extenders, defense, bombs. The quality of the cards, so like starters work, like they all plus one, or like most of it, like two-thirds of the starters plus one. And then there's the cross-functional roles, right? Defense is searchable. The starters are all good in the late game. They're all bombs. The bomb multi-role is itself a combo enabler. If you have like that with Area Zero plus a Draco spell is a pseudo starter if you don't have a starter. So the cross roll functionality feeds into my decision to play this deck. Yeah, so like just being able to generate advantage, have good ratios, cross functionality between card rolls, like all of those things are qualities you want in the deck. It has to be resilient through side decking, which Striker and Draco are. And it has to be resilient through luck, which I didn't mention that, but it just comes to mind that that's so important. So if you remember my tournament report just now, it was a very long report, and think to, how many matches came down to me losing to bad luck? A small handful, a very, very small handful. And then out of those, how many came down to my opponent's deck versus my deck? So I lost a Wrath game 3 in Top Cut, unfortunately. It's like the worst time to lose to luck, but that was one of my only break hands across all three tournaments. I had a few others. If your deck loses to itself once per day of tournament, like once per tournament day, like if there's 8 rounds of Swiss day 1, and it bricks like once in 8 rounds, and that brick, or maybe not bricks once in 8 rounds, but a brick causes a loss 1 in 8 rounds, then I think that's like the threshold for a consistent deck. If it can't do better than that, like if you find yourself bricking like twice in like 5 rounds, for instance, it's probably not the deck that you should even be considering. You have to be a little bit lucky to win YCS, but you can't be that lucky. Like, it has to be something very, very consistent. Like there's enough rounds in a premier event to cancel out a ton of variants. So those are the qualities I look for in a deck. And there's certainly other qualities that you want in a deck, but those are just a few that I want to name. As far as metagaming, so earlier I talked about how like my thought process into addressing the contradictions with Lunalike Orcist hands, right? Because their hands, some of them lose to one hand trap, but beat the other, and then other hands will beat the hand trap and lose to the first one. So those contradictions make the deck very good and make it very hard to side against their strategy. Only no material is categorically good against all hands, but then the rest is situation dependent, and permanence is pretty good. So adjusting my side was the key to sustainably improving after Niagara. So metagame is crucial as well. You saw how many matches I played against Moonlight Orcus. So even though it's only 8% of my results, can't perform without it. You can't perform without any of these four, right? So gone over the basics on this. We've gone over a lot of fundamentals on metagaming. Mind games. There was one mind game I shared about like tricking my opponent into using Dingersu on, the card that I wanted him to use it on. And I'm still not sure if it was like correct on his part, but I do know that I certainly encouraged him to do it. You can look at stuff like, Thomas Rose and Jonas, the final that they played this year. Thomas is able to confidently represent a set Jackalope in order to trick Jonas into basically just not attacking for game to win OICS. So, there's plenty of examples of mind games. But basically, using the motion of your hands to suggest things, to represent things that are untrue. If you have Nibiru, don't represent Nibiru. If you don't have Nibiru, represent Nibiru. One other comment I would make about that particular action is don't oversell. I learned this, my first stop was YCS San Diego 2013. I faced a Long Dao in day 2 of Swiss, and he was my one loss in Swiss that day. Basically, I meant to turn like an Abyss Lens into defense, but like it turns out that mistake was okay because I had a set Mirror Force, right? But the thing is, I over-exaggerated my own disappointment in myself for turning that abyssal into defense. And because I oversold that disappointment, he read me like a book and just like played around mirror force, and he just destroyed me as a result. So, yeah, you know, represent what you don't have. Don't represent what you do have, but also just don't oversell, because a decent player will read right through and oversell. And then, as I mentioned already, Swiss rounds of Fort Worth, when I faced the Pendulum player who was indecisive about whether to choose first or second the next game, you know, his emotions gave away that he did not have Banco Seca in his deck, among other things. Like, I'm sure there was more information to extract from those behaviors. But, you know, like, a player's behavior can reveal so much about what they are and aren't doing and have and don't have in their deck if you just think critically about it. And there's not like a shortcut to developing this knowledge, but you just have to, you know, have a lot of match experience. And then drawing from that match experience, you can then start to think of entirely new tricks. I mean, you look at a player like Simon He, his, you know, history notwithstanding, he's a very brilliant mind game player. And he is so because he has that technical foundation and plays good decks and he understands the meta and what they can do. And so as a result, he's like able to you know, harvest all that experience in the other three quadrants in order to leverage the ability to come up with entirely new tricks that nobody else knows. And yeah, I mean, he's a player whose mind game level I respect extraordinarily. So, you know, mind games don't win a tournament, but they can, you know, play a deciding factor in getting you to that next level. But you have to have the foundations first. You can arguably win an event without mind games. I think it's much harder, but arguably. But you cannot win an event without all of this down very, very solid. So that's mind games. And then the last thing I wanted to cover was technical play. So as someone who is honestly not the greatest deck builder, I have to say that I love the technical aspect of Yu-Gi-Oh! It's my strength. It's what I love about playing cards. And while I do recognize that deck building is what, you know, kind of creates legends, you know, multiple time champions, it's essential. It's probably the more important expertise to have. Tech is just what I love about Yu-Gi-Oh! I mean, I'm just a very quantitative person. And so one of my favorite things to do is like to like calculate percentages in real time when I'm like mid game, which is something that I think, you know, the average players or, you know, even above average players aren't going to be able to do. So a long time ago, Chris Bowling had he has like a poker channel now, but a long time ago, Chris Bowling's channel was a Yu-Gi-Oh! Channel. And there was one video he shot where he taught how he like examines his deck for consistency. He takes like a 40 card deck and he breaks it up into 8 hands of 5. And so to this day, I think that exercise is like really neat and useful for a number of things. And so I wanted to go ahead and do that with my deck to kind of, you know, go through some real time like scenarios and examples to kind of like, I'm gonna react to my own hands. So like that, it's not premeditated, it's all freestyle. And kind of showcase in real time like what a player's thought process is when, you know, how they run the variables when they look at their opening hand. So, you know, the first thing that I drew is unfortunately 2 copies of Nibiru, Area Zero, Widow Anchor, Shark Cannon. So if you're facing, this is interesting. It looks like a losing hand going first. But if you're facing combo, you have Nibiru to ensure that you see your next draw phase. And if you're facing control, they can't kill you. So you can potentially get to your next draw phase naturally anyway. And then on top of that, if you're facing Striker, then Widow Anchor can serve as a pseudo starter to get to Ray. And this is all assuming that you use Area Zero on Shark Cannon and that you whiff on a striker card, which is, I want to say, is less than a 20% occurrence. And so out of those striker cards, a good chunk of them will get you to where you need to be. So this hand looks like a losing hand, but there's a lot of potential in it, whether it's control or combo. I mean, I think during my Swiss rounds, I certainly had hands where I saw those hands and I'm like, well, if my opponent's playing combo, I lose. But then they're playing control and I just win that game. So a little bit of luck involved. So, but anyway, yeah, with that hand, I would probably set, I would set the sharp cannon, use area zero on sharp cannon. Hope that gets me there. It has a higher probability of doing so. But if it doesn't, then yeah, I have Nibiru for if they're playing combo, and then I have the natural ability to live if they're playing control. Okay, so second hand out of eight is, I don't know how visible it is, but we have Disciples of the True Draco Phoenix, Area Zero, Engage, Set Rotation, Ignis. And so as I mentioned in my deck profile, Set Rotation by itself is an FTK. This hand will probably end with 13 cards. Like, there's a good chance. Five in the back row, six in hand, including engage, at least one engage. Shizuku with Ray in the Grave, and a diagram. Okay, so how do you actually play this hand? So there's a few interesting lines of play, right? Like, there's a number of ways to play this hand that can all result in game, but there's definitely one, like, best way. Because even if you do it like a really, really strong play, there's always that slight chance that your opponent can open the counter nuts to your nuts. So if you have the nuts and they have the counter nuts, you lose. So it's important to play the hand perfectly, not just really, really well. So just looking at this hand, what I see is an opportunity to draw a lot of cards off Heritage. Set Rotation will get you to Diagram. And I would like to be able to draw two off Heritage, not just one. So I'm not going to Diagram pop Disciples. I'm not going to do that. I'm going to do Disciples, Effect, Tribute, Ignis, Diagram, Destroy. This is why we have to think about it. Okay, sorry. There's a shortcut to know. Shortcuts are everything. It's a lot easier to do when just looking at your hand, but when you have to like hold it and also like talk, it's hard to see the right play sometimes. So a shortcut to know is that if Set Rotation locks you out of playing field spells, if you play Set Rotation, you're locked out of Area Zero until you're able to pop your opponent's Area Zero that you set for them. So with that in mind, it might be better just to do Area Zero and then use the effects of Area Zero on the Tribute Summoned Ignis. Does that work? Yeah, that's one way to do it. So that could potentially get you a striker card, right? And I would say like not a small percentage of the time you get a really broken card like Engage, Widow Anchor, Multi-Role, you know? So you can do that. So Effective Disciples, Tribute Summon, Ignis, Air Zero on Ignis, get a card. You can play Step Rotation. No, that's not it either. It's really hard to narrate and think at the same time. I want that double here to draw. So, yeah, I'm not sure that I see a way to get a double Heritage draw. And so this is like playing in an unrealistic manner, right? Because like in a real game, you can't review every line of play. And so you have to intuitively just like see the shortcut. So like, you know, you can, this area zero won't be live if you place that rotation first, not usually. So you have to decide, like, do you want to hold area zero or do you want to set rotation right away? But either way, I think you just have to pop disciples and pop area zero and get a one draw off heritage. And then from there, you can just do multi-role plays with engage. Make sure you draw a card off engage. And then when you get Ray, make sure you use the tag effect for Kagari instead of link summoning Kagari so that they don't shark cannon it later if they're playing Striker. But yeah, I mean, if anyone out there watching can see a way to get two heritage draws off that hand, I mean, I think it's just the fact that it's the middle of the night and I've been doing this for hours after sleep deprivation that I can't see it. I don't see the play, but that hand's broken. So if you see a double heritage draw, then, you know, more power to you. But I'm often looking for those things. Okay, so this hand is Terraforming, Double Heritage, Apocalypse, Return. All Draco hands are bad, but this is playable. Ash is not super common right now, so you don't have to fear Ash too much. Because you don't have Ray access with this hand, what that means is you have to go for a crazy good draw of Heritage, which means like bet everything on green. So Terraforming for Diagram. Diagram. Pop. Apocalypse. Well, return. For Ignis. Heritage, Tribute. Ignis. Over Heritage. Heritage, pop, apocalypse, apocalypse, pop, pop, Ignis. And then from there you can draw three off heritage. And you have your normal summon preserved. So if you draw any of the three spellbook starters, if you draw Ray, if you draw Hornet Drones, if you draw Engage, I mean, like, you're in a very, very good position. And because Ash is not prominent right now, like, that play is much safer EV than in, say, you know, this summer's format or the format before that. But when you have a hand like this, like, you should not play just regular Draco beatdown, unless, like, you know what they're playing. But, like, barring specific knowledge, if you're blind to playing, you should just go for the heritage draw for three and put all your chips on that because you need to get to Ray. And so I guess that's kind of where metagaming comes in. Is your typical play is affected by the metagame. Like, if you know that Ash is in everyone's main deck, then that's probably not the play, right? So, yeah. Like, all these factors factor into tech play. Okay, so next hand is Area Zero, Multi-Role, Widow Anchor, Ignis, Dynamite. So, as good of a card as Widow Anchor is, I don't index it super duper high. So I think I would play the Area Zero, set Widow Anchor, and then use the effect to attempt to grab something. If it doesn't grab anything, then I have a Widow Anchor set. And then from there, you can do Area Zero, multi-roll, trigger the Area Zero to get Ray. And again, because no one's playing Ash right now, like, it's a super safe play. And from there, you can grab engage. So, yeah, this hand's a little bit weird because obviously you're not tributing multi-role for either Draco card. So the Dracos are going to be a little bit unplayable for a second. But again, like, this deck is so good at drawing deep into the deck that it's also just a really good shot that Area Zero gets you to, like, a card that lets you draw. But if it doesn't, like, you're still all right. But I think with that particular hand just now, it's probably a little bit more vulnerable to an OTK than usual. Okay, Next hand is, it has one of the combinations that we really hate to see, is when you draw spellbook cards together. So there's a Secrets, a Magician, a Knowledge, a Nibiru, and Diagram. So what really sucks here is that of all the spellbooks to draw together, you draw the combination that leaves dead secrets in deck. So you can't even like fish it out just to like filter your deck and put in an extra spell in grave. Drawing your Garnet, of course, is always unwanted, but drawing it with additional spellbooks is even further unwanted, which is why you're not seeing like three copies of Spellbook of Secrets. But yeah, I mean, you have to do what you have to do. Actually, I was wrong earlier about not being able to fish out the fourth copy. My mistake. So you just normal summon Spellbook Magician, right? And then you grab Secrets, and from there, play Knowledge, send Magician to grave. I know that sending Secrets to grave is an option, but clearing out the main monster zone is just super important, because those next two draws can get you something like Engage, or you know how Striker works. And then the fact that you have Diagram in hand is also really nice. So of all the hands to open the Garnet in, we much prefer to open Garnet with, starters, because then the brick is not really a brick. And so I don't think that was even the worst hand that we saw, despite having the worst combination, like the most undesirable combination. This is an all spell hand, so it looks really, really nice. Play Upstart. And then from here, I think you can kind of distinguish like good players from more advanced players, average players from like more advanced players. I think average players would kind of just like vomit their hand. Like you see a hand this good and you want to just like play all the engages, right? And just go for everything. But again, I mean, I think one of the reasons that Christian Arena topped is because he had the wisdom to play conservatively with his power cards. And so with this hand, you have to kind of just acknowledge that like it has the potential to amass advantage for a larger blowout later, and that there's no point in just vomiting everything onto the field right off the bat, because depending on what you draw with Upstart, you can just play one of the engages and then safely get your way to triple engage for the next turn. But of course, that all is contingent upon what Upstart draws. All right, so next hand is Diagram, Apocalypse, Ignis, Ray. And so going back to the theme of shortcuts are everything, because in a real tournament setting, we can't do what we're doing here, where I just lab everything out and contemplate very thoughtfully what are all the options. In a tournament setting, you're gonna get slow play warnings and a game loss if you play in that methodical way. It's not chess, right? You have to memorize shortcuts, which means sometimes you make the suboptimal play. Like if you think back to the second hand that I drew, like in a real tournament, I can't just sit there the way that I did just now. I have to just do the Heritage draw one play. I can't sit and think, is there a way for this hand to draw Heritage, like to draw two cards off Heritage? Like it's a fun puzzle to think about, but in tournament, you have to just look at the hand and be like, I don't see it, I'm gonna draw one off Heritage, right? So, okay. So that aside, when I see two Diagram, what I see is a really big Heritage draw. And then also on top of that, when I see the Ray, that tells me that you can't afford to normal summon the Ignis. Now, the Heritage draw can get you to Magician, in which case Magician comes first, not Ray. Because there are no ways to summon Ray and then Magician in the same turn, but there are some ways to Magician and then get Ray on field, or at least a Hornet Drone into Shizuku, whatever, on field same turn. So because of this truth, if the Heritage gets you to Magician, summon the Magician. So what do we have here? So this kind of sucks, because if this were pure Draco, I would normal summon Ignis, no problem. But the normal summon is so precious in this hand. So I would love to be able to tribute summon Apocalypse for Ignis and then pop it with Diagram for Heritage, draw two. And by drawing two, it allows, instead of three, it allows me to keep the second Diagram in hand as a follow-up. Like, I hate vomiting Diagrams, and I think, like, you'll find that with most decks, like, good players should despise, like, you know, vomiting their hand when unnecessary. Like, that's how you lose against control decks. So, but because this normal summon of Ray is so precious, the only play that's even available is Diagram, pop, Apocalypse. So you do that, you get Disciples. Disciples affect tribute for Ignis, play the second Diagram, Diagram, pop, Ignis, Heritage, draw three. And, you know, I hate vomiting Diagrams out like that, because if it's like a true Draco opponent, or if it's, I don't know, Striker, and they main deck like Cosmic, which a lot of them do now, so it's a little bit risky. Like, it's not the most risk in the world. Like, you're still going to open Godly. Like, your ending will be Godly from this hand. But in general, you want to be really conservative with Diagram, and that's a habit that I learned through playing a ton of pure Draco. I'm simultaneously both proud and embarrassed to say that I'm, like, one of the most experienced Draco players on the planet. Put way too much time playing that deck at Premier events than I should have. But yeah, so that's kind of why we're here playing this deck. All right, so the last hand is these five. Apocalypse, Disciples, Ray, Spellbook of Secrets. Okay, so that's really cool, because this hand illustrates the exact point that I just made the previous hand. So your shortcut here is that Secrets, Search Blue Boy, Search Knowledge. Like, you have to do that even though you have a normal summon Ray opportunity. And yes, sometimes you will draw that second Ray, and then your Area Zero can't get you to a Ray summon. And it's less than desired, but this order of operations is, you know, more or less essential. But then again, to the point I made earlier when I was talking about my match with Angel, maybe there are situations where it really is correct to summon Ray. I would think, as far as turn zeros go in blind matchups, I don't think there's ever a situation to do so. But in more complex game states, or going second, there may very well be a matchup where that's just correct. And so, like, everything that you're supposed to do 99% of the time, there's still that 1% of the time where you have to break character and do what's unconventional. And so, again, I think that's one of the things that distinguishes, you know, very good players from the very best players. And so I don't know that I've experienced a situation yet where I had to do that, but just a comment that I wanted to make, because this deck is very much an order of operations oriented deck, it's important to keep in mind the principle that you have to be mindful of when you have to break from operations. Because that's what makes or breaks like a top level performance, you know. A whole group of us played this deck at the event, but, you know, certainly not everyone was able to run deep. And those, just having all four of these dimensions down is the key to maximizing those odds. And just really quickly, maybe just a couple of hands going second. So, just to give you an idea. Oh, actually, that reminds me of another thing. One last attribute when choosing a good deck that I did mention, among all the other attributes I already described, is that it has to play to go first. Well, not always. I mean, the game has changed so much recently. But I mean, generally speaking, like, if you can, you should build a deck to go first. I know that they're exceptional formats. You know, it's not a universal rule. But generally speaking, if you can build to go first, to go first, but your deck has to be really, really good going second too. And I think too often people choose decks that just don't fit both criteria. So this hand is Diagram, Disciples, Ray, Widow Anchor, Multi-Role, Ignis. So one of the lessons that I learned from my loss to Stryker in Guadalajara is to be very conservative with that multi-role. And I mean, it's just Yu-Gi-Oh fundamentals, right? Like don't summon BLS right away if you have Chaos Sorcerer in hand. You know, like don't play your bombs first. And I mean, sometimes you have to because multi-role can work as a pseudo starter. But I mean, in general though, be very, very conservative with it. But depending on what you're up against, you know, you want to keep in mind your options. So you want to keep in mind things like you can normal summon both monsters because you have disciples. You want to keep in mind things that you can pop your own Ignis to get a heritage draw for two. You want to keep in mind, like, what if they out your diagram and you need to trigger disciples for whatever reason? Multiple can do that for you, so that's something else to keep in mind. Similarly, what if you summon the Ignis and you're like, oh no, I committed to Ignis and I need to make my main monster zones open up. I need to open them up for Widow Anger. Multi-role on Ignis can help with that as well. So just, you know, some obvious but important, you know, relationships to understand. And so like when it comes to like hybrid decks, it's important that there's a lot of that inherent synergy in the deck. Okay, so this hand is Nibiru, Ignis, Heritage, Hornet Drones, Engage, Heritage. So, keeping to the theme of shortcuts, in general, like you don't want to Hornet Drones unless you can get Raid to Grave first. But, let's see. So this is what's going through my mind. Is if you spend Engage to get Ray, you don't have the Hornet Drones, and you can Shizuku and Gari and whatever with like the assurance of Ray and Grave to protect you. But what I don't like about that is that the Engage doesn't draw one off that. So in my mind, if I see this opening hand, I'm thinking like, well, is there another, like, can I get the three spells in Grave? Is there a likelihood of doing that if I don't do that play? And I mean, I don't immediately know, it like depends on what they have, but it's just something to keep in mind. Because if the opportunity cost of drawing a card isn't even actually there, like if you don't actually have a way to get to that draw, then you may as well just engage for the Ray or whatever else that you need. So just something to keep in mind. And then of course, you know, the Heritage and Ignis like naturally break boards, and if you can get them to destroy your Ignis for you, like that's really, really nice because you have a second Heritage that they don't know that you have, so that you can draw extra cards off that. All right, so this is Dynamite, Ignis, Disciples, Area Zero, Apocalypse, Upstart, Goblin. All right, so Upstart first, and then this is interesting. So as you can see, Area Zero and Disciples together get you to Ray access. So shortcut, and so going second, you would prioritize the Ignis summon. If you can summon Ignis, then you can potentially trigger its effect, get the Heritage to draw cards. But it's just tricky because if they know what they're doing, they might not allow that. And then on top of that, the Ignis will clog your main monster zones. So those are just some thoughts that are going through my head. I mean, I can't give a specific line of play without seeing what they have and what Upstart Goblin draws. Those are just some shortcuts that kind of like run through my mind. All right, maybe just do one more. So this hand is Shark Cannon, Apocalypse, Set Rotation, Nibiru, Secrets, and Knowledge. So, I mean, and this hand's pretty dope going second because Nibiru gives you coverage over like a whole host of bad matchups. Of course, if they have Moonlight Orcus, they'll probably win. Or not win, but like, you know, set up their board anyway. So yeah, it sucks to draw Garnet, but going second, it's not nearly as bad. So I think in this hand is pretty inconsequential. The Set Rotation gives you diagram access, but if anything, I'll play Spellbook of Secrets first and foremost, and then summon the Blue Boy. So then here is an opportunity to go for Mind Tricks. So how can you get more value out of the fact that you opened two spellbook cards, which is, you know, less than ideal? you know, perhaps you can move your arms in such a way that encourages them, like that telegraphs to them that you really need Blue Boy to go through. Or maybe not your arms, maybe you can show it in your face. You just don't oversell it, but like if there's a way that you can potentially just subconsciously get your opponent to suspect that all your play hinges on getting Blue Boy's search, you can potentially bait negation. And then from there you would get amazing value because you have knowledge in hand, and you know that minus one turned into break even, and then with the draw two you actually plus off that play. So you know, this subtle thing obviously is not make or break. If the sell doesn't work, then you're still fine, you don't lose. If the sell does work but they don't have negation, then it didn't matter. So that kind of just goes back to the point that the mind tricks, there's just a small part of Yu-Gi-Oh! But at the same time, like what differentiates top players is that they're always attempting them. So yes, I know that you probably are not going to negate Blue Boy. Even if you have negation, you're probably not going to. But it doesn't mean I'm not going to try to sell it to you, you know? Because if there's a way to get value beyond just the text printed on the card, then you should go for that value. So yeah, Blue Boy play first. And then from there, like, you know, there's a host of plays you can do. It really depends on what they have and what you draw. But yeah, that's my only comment on that one. So yeah, I mean, there's so much to say about technical play. I mean, these are just opening hands, which is just the literal surface of the iceberg. I think, like, going back to this, tech is one of my favorite things about Yu-Gi-Oh, but it's actually not the opening hands that I like the most. What I really, really love is solving convoluted game states. And that's something that I can't illustrate today, perhaps in the future. But, you know, I just wanted to hit that one last dimension, you know, before I sign off. And then lastly, just acknowledgments. You know, I've already thanked the people I wanted to thank in my typed up tournament report, but just to kind of rehash and reiterate that, you know, shout outs to Ed, he is my rock. Shout outs to Andrea, my friend overseas. Shout outs to friends of old who I respect immensely, you know, Gally and Sam and Joshua and Paolo, Chris LeBlanc and Pat, of course, my co-founder and, you know, living legend of Yu-Gi-Oh, who developed a lot of the theory that you saw today. And shout out to everyone at Niagara who let me borrow cards, because I showed up to that event with zero cards in hand because the airline had my bag with my cards in it. So I had to borrow 70 cards and recreate my deck from scratch that morning, and I was able to do so thanks to everyone who helped, especially the annual. So I really appreciate that. Shout outs to of course Noah and Ryan and Colby. Noah and Colby especially have been so dedicated to this deck, like long before I even thought it was good. And so, like, when they first brought it up to me, like way back when Striker was tier zero, I was like, this is silly, just play Sky Striker, it's strictly the better deck. But as the formats went on, this deck kind of crept its way into more playability. I don't know at what point it truly became playable. I probably played pure Draco for too long, but yeah, I probably should have made the switch earlier, like before Nibiru format, if anything. So definitely shout outs to them, and shout outs to everyone who's just been, I've been meeting at events. It's just a pleasure to meet so many of you, especially after like some of you I've talked to for years and I've only just met recently at these events. And David Flores, of course, you know, my long-term and most dedicated test partner, just everyone else that I theorize with. I guess just also a quick shout out to the True Draco Duelist Facebook group. I would love to do a True Draco clinic with you guys sometime, because I think everyone gets True Draco wrong, and like they kind of misunderstand its potential. It deserves its own segment, but if I could just say a quick word on that, it's that Draco's strength is not in the floodgates. Floodgates subtract cards from you, and they don't win tournaments, they don't attack for game, they don't add resources, but the Draco cards do. And so with that said, if in the future pure Drago becomes the deck to play, I really think that everyone gets it wrong by playing Floodgates, with the exception being if there's a one dominant tier zero deck, in which case you should play Floodgates just for that one deck. But yeah, I think true Drago players are doing themselves a disservice by playing all the Floodgate cards like Inspector Border and the continuous traps. Like, that's not what makes true Drago great. Like Diagram and Ignis and Dynamite, and the fact that the spells and traps each have three effects is what makes true Drago great. And so you should be playing cards that increase your cards. So just some thoughts on that. So to all the true Drago duelist players in that Facebook group, if you're playing pure Drago, like, focus on like finding cards that add to your resources, because cards that prevent your opponent from playing don't win events, they don't top events, because eventually you're gonna face an opponent who just has Twin Boosters, and then the natural advantage of their engine will overpower your, like, the fact that you're lower on resources. And yeah, then just, you know, shout outs to everyone else in the community. If there's anyone else that I'm not acknowledging at this, you know, final hour, I apologize. Oh yeah, Ben, of course, for giving me all that Lunar Light Orcist help. And just like everyone else who has interacted with me and advised me as someone who loves Yu-Gi-Oh! But unfortunately is not available to, you know, work on this game actively. I have to do all that I can to shortcut things and leverage past experiences to continue to perform currently in the present, and so that wouldn't be possible without the help of a multitude of advisors. So I really appreciate that. And lastly, I just a final comment is, like, the reason I do these segments and write articles is, I mean, of course, one is that I just love the game, but the other is, because I, as much as I would love to answer all of your questions individually, I just simply don't have the availability for that. So so I hope that, you know, by being able to send, you know, the same information out to the masses, that I can address, you know, multiple people and in effect have the equivalent of conversations with each and every one of you, since I'm just not available to speak with you each individually. All right, so I hope that you appreciated and got some kind of value add from this content. And I apologize if I'm just not haven't been my most eloquent or mentally present self. Finals week was a real killer and I barely feel alive at this moment. But in any case, it was nevertheless a pleasure to do, because this is the game that I most know and love.